Adventure
on Pipeman
on
W4CY Radio.
Wake up, America! It's time for the Adventures of Pipeman on W4CY.com, West Palm Beach's number one internet radio station. Here's your host, the Pipeman.
This is the Pipe Man here on the Adventures Pipe Man W4CY Radio, and I'm here with...
You're with Starbenders from Atlanta, Georgia. I'm Kimmy Shelter. I'm the lead singer and rhythm guitar player.
I'm Emily Moon. I play drums.
I'm Aaron. I play bass.
I'm Chris. I play guitar.
Nice. So Aftershock, how does it feel to be at Aftershock? Cool festival, right?
Yeah, it's really awesome. Super organized and just awesome bands. Very, very nice.
So since you're from Atlanta... have you ever performed or been at the Shaky Knees Festival?
We've gone to the Shaky Knees Festival, but we've yet to play it, which is something that chaps our ass.
From Atlanta.
I know, you should.
Yeah, it's weird.
That should be like a given, right?
Yes, we're going to send around a paper trying to get us on the... Yeah.
Yeah, just keep hawking them until they're like, yeah. We need them to leave us alone. Just put them on the bill.
Yeah, this is unacceptable.
You know what I didn't like about Shaky Knees is, oh my God, there's no parking in your town. What is up with that?
Any traffic, parking, car-related activity in Atlanta is going to be a bitch for
sure. Like, especially where that festival is. It's funny because there were cops, and I'm like, normal thing. Can I park here? He goes, I don't know. I'm like, what do you mean you don't know? Well, that's not our area. I'm like, but you're the one giving out tickets. Well, you'll have to ask, what is it that they call it there that handles the traffic stuff? I forget now.
Oh, GDOT?
No, it's like some agency. I don't even remember, but...
We have a Department of Public Safety.
Something like that. Some county thing.
Yeah.
I'm like, really? The cops don't know what's legal and what's not?
They don't care either.
No, they didn't. That's the point. So, but here at Aftershock, how cool is this vibe back here, right? Like this whole area, the artist, media area. Most festivals don't have this.
Yeah, it's really beautiful, and it really helps us when places kind of take the artist and the media and everybody into consideration, because we're out here all day, you know, and it really helps, like, having nice places to sit and do these kinds of things in.
And did you see the food? There's a chef out there making food.
Yeah, it's awesome. And, you know, it just makes it fun.
I know, right?
Which is why we're here.
See, I think they're so smart because that's when the artists want to hang in the press tent and stuff like this. Otherwise, they want to avoid it usually.
Yes.
Because too many people are asking, how'd you get your band name? Which you'll never hear me ask. So tell the listeners, if they haven't heard your music before, how you would describe your music. Not from a genre necessarily, because that just boxes artists in.
Yeah.
I like to hear how the artists express themselves.
I think we are an aggressive, ethereal, emotional, whimsical rock band.
That's a great... That should be a new genre.
It's a wide
right there.
Spectrum of emotions and characters, if you will.
I think should be that way, though, right? I mean, music is emotion, you know?
I think a lot of our favorite bands collectively as a band were bands like that. They weren't bands you could really put in the box necessarily.
Right.
Like The Cure is one of our favorite bands, and they had such a wide spectrum of sounds. So, it's kind of nice to be able to say it in that way, because it's like, well, we kind of like Blondie or like Bowie and this and that. We're always, you know, I think there's multiple ways to describe who we are as a band.
And I think when you blend different influences, you can't be compared to another band because you're uniquely you.
Yeah, and it's tough because that's how people like to ask questions or learn about things. They want you to tell them
they want
exactly
your label.
Yeah, they so it's hard because, as a friend of ours has referred to us, we're tweeners. So we're between genres and things like that. And
I like that.
I don't think we've fully been necessarily classified So we just keep doing what's natural to us, and we've been really lucky because the four of us match one another really well in terms of our capabilities on our instruments.
That's important.
So we've always been just able to keep climbing and growing just as musicians, and we've been able to maintain and protect our joy in this, which has been really important.
Sounds like there's no ego, too, because just you saying about the matching in musical instruments and stuff like that, like usually when there's ego, that's the death of a band.
Yeah, and I think there's, with us, like, to me, it's always important to acknowledge the ego, but
right.
There's a quote about not redecorating the abyss.
Yeah.
You know, so we try not to do that.
Yeah. It's good to have an ego, but not an out of control egomaniac ego.
Yeah, I think that it's one of those things where once you look at it, the dynamic changes. So as soon as you pull that ego out of your peripheral and into your direct line of sight, you're able to address it in a different way.
And get along better.
Absolutely. You can invite your demons to dinner with you.
Right? And you end up understanding each other. I think that's what happens a lot of times is sometimes because they're not matched, they don't really understand the other person's perspective. And that's important.
Yeah, we've been really lucky too because I think each of us as individuals has had that hunger and that drive to get to where we're going. We're all seekers in our own different way, whether it be, you know, all of us operate within different mediums, but because we're all each holding up four corners, nobody's necessarily occupying the same space at any given time. So we're able to like really play off of each other's strengths and weaknesses in that way, both in our personal dynamics and on stage as well.
So since you have such a good chemistry together, how did you guys all meet then?
Kimmy and I knew one another before this band. I just remember when she called me and said, dude, we're going to do another band. Let's do it. And so, I mean, I was on board. But when Chris and Emily came, that was the final piece. That was our born on date. And so that's when the band really like started to take off, both musically and like career-wise. That's when we started actually doing more things. So
You knew right away.
I will also say this, like it's less important like how we met and more important to note that like it was the stars coming together and aligning, and if anything had been a little bit different, we would not have Starbenders today. So I'm profoundly grateful that we all came together when we did.
Say something. Craigslist isn't dead, y'all. It might be dead now, but in 2017 it wasn't dead. That's actually how I met the band.
Nice.
Craigslist, yeah. So
that kind of reminds me of like bands in the old days, answered an ad like Metallica.
Yeah, looking for lead guitar player. Yeah, yeah.
You know, that's how Metallica started.
Yes.
An ad.
Yes.
You know?
Yeah.
And I love that nowadays there's still bands like you that are using that because to me that's organic. You know, it happens. You know if there's a vibe. You know if there's chemistry. And then boom, you know, that's a long-lasting band.
Yeah, and that's why we keep fighting for it. And I think in this day and age, everything's disposable and everything's thrown out. You know, everything's single use. And, you know, nobody even, like, views something like marriage as being, like, it used to be like, oh, you're with that person forever. Now it's like, oh, that's going to be my third ex-wife, you know, whatever.
Well, so. It's funny you should say that because there's two things I'll say on that point. One is people go into marriages nowadays with the idea of, oh, if it doesn't work, I can get divorced. And that's stupid.
Yeah, there's an out, you know, and we're essentially married because we're in a legally binding contract with one another.
That's right.
So we just keep fighting for one another and it keeps making sense. And, you know, it's been a long and winding road for us. But anytime that we start to or I start to feel overwhelmed, I just read the lyrics to, you know, AC/DC is a long way to the top if you want to rock and roll.
Well, you know what they say. It takes about 20 years to become an overnight success.
Oh, yeah. So, we're really looking forward to people talking shit about how we sold out.
I know, right? Yeah. So it's funny. We were talking about Metallica. That's a perfect example because I went to like the first Metallica show ever. And so the 25 of us, which were their fans, when they made the Black Album, we're like, fuck them posers. We're not listening to them again. But you know what? At the end of the day, where they were smart, is, yes, they may have lost us then, and they gained millions, and we all came back anyway. So, you know, I think, listen, if you're going to be an artist, that whole sellout thing, I used to be like that when I was a teenager, but listen, this is how you got to make your living if this is what you're really going to do. So it's not really selling out. It's growing and maturing and becoming a career, you know?
Yeah. I think, honestly, like, what's always guided us in the right direction is, like, serving the song and serving the band as an idea. And that's always kind of led us in the right path, no matter how dark things got, even when, you know, even a couple of years ago when nobody could tour, I think we always just, like, held strong to what this band really meant to us. And, you know, and here we are, you know.
That's a good point you brought up, because I think two things happened from that lockdown. Either bands disbanded, or bands found each other, or bands found their real calling, because, you know, you guys as artists, you're on this hamster wheel, and you really don't have time to stop and think where you want things to go.
Yeah.
And that kind of forced artists to stop and think, is this really where I want to be going, or do I want to shift gears?
Yeah, I mean, and the record we just put out definitely has that introspective element to it. You know, like a lot of people that put out music in the same era, if you will. I think we, you know, we did take the time to really look into ourselves as a band, and what came out was this really visceral group of songs, you know, that I feel like really represent us live and in the studio.
I love that. You know, and I will say that what a tough time to come through being an artist. So if you're an artist still after that time, my hat's off to you, because I don't think people realize how rough mentally and everything else it is to be an artist through that lockdown period.
Yeah, and I mean, you know, I think we had a lot of compassion for people in every walk of life, but we continued to kind of talk about the metaphor of, like, the band playing as the ship goes down, and that's what musicians had to do during that time. We had to kind of, like, keep creating as, like, all of these systems were being challenged and all this kind of stuff. And so, honestly, our producer, mentor, sensei, Nico Constantine, played a really big part in that, like, because he had his knee in our back the whole time, and, like, was kind of, like, a really fearless leader for us at that time, and we were able to, like, keep pushing and keep moving, and he found a way to make it so that we were able to do that financially and otherwise, to be able to keep creating, and our label as well. So between him and our label, like, we were actually really lucky, and we just fought it out, and, you know, we had an opportunity to get healthier during that time.
Nice.
And look at some of the stuff that had been sort of unattended to. So, you know, here we are at Aftershock 2023.
Yes. Nice.
I love it. Tell everybody how they reach out to you guys on socials, on the web, buy your merch, check out your music, tour dates, all that stuff.
Yeah, all you have to do is type Starbenders into Google, and there she is. The best way to reach us is on Instagram, but we're on all the socials, so just seek and you shall find.
That's another thing nowadays. I think of artists, like, I remember back in the days we had the tape trading days and all that. And now to be an artist, it's a lot of freaking work. None of those bands back then had to do that much work. Their biggest work was stapling flyers on telephone poles.
Yeah.
Now, like, social media, even, like, TikTok's a full-time job, man.
It is.
Like, I have, like, mad respect for people that do TikToks, because it's like, I don't have 8 hours to do a one-minute TikTok.
Yeah. It's definitely a new world.
Yeah, you guys have to work so much harder. That's why people need to support bands, support you by buying merch, you know, because it's the only way you really survive. And, you know,
we're out here, and we love all the people that still are loving music and rock and roll and coming to these things, and people like you keeping things going and turning people on to cool new things. And we really appreciate all of it. And if you see us on the street, say, hey, we're all real nice. We might look a little scary, but we don't bite.
But you might want. It's funny. I was talking to another artist I was friends with, and we were talking about how people think metalheads are scary. And he was like, let's keep them thinking that.
Yeah. Metalheads are the absolute sweetest people. Well, and we're all metalheads here in this band too, but you know, it's really funny because our like softer, more ballad songs, like those are what the metal guys will come up to us and say they like, because we'll play the heavy shit and I'll be like, you like that? You like that, man? And they're like, I like the ballad.
Right?
You know? Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Listen, as a total thrash metalhead, one of my favorite ever Metallica songs is Nothing Else Matters.
Oh, yeah.
So that goes against everything that I should believe.
Yeah, and I think it's songs like that, you like, you need that contrast. And
totally.
I think that that's what's exciting about being a band that's open, and that's, it gives you such a breath of like more possibilities.
As an artist, you should be able to be open and just create, you know, instead of, oh, you need to create it just like this or any other box they put you in.
Yes, we like exercising our neuroplasticity and making sure that we stay limbly bimbly
there
as we go forward.
I love it. Any final words you want to leave our listeners with that we haven't covered yet?
Keep rocking, Aftershock.
Yes.
Chris is like, kick teeth, kick teeth.
Nice.
Dyslexia, stuff.
Well, you guys rock. I'm so glad you're here at Aftershock, and thanks for being on the Adventures of Pipeman.
Oh, yeah, thank you. We love you. Have a great one.
Thank you for listening to the Adventures of Pipeman on W4CY Radio.